98. We all have a really cohesive team, the attendings and the nurses and the MEAs, radiology.
You've been shot in the chest before?
Every member of the team has a specific role. Emergency.
Everyone knows they have to work really hard and they have to work together and they depend on each other.
And it looks like a steak knife.
The United States is a melting pot. We're the stew.
This place is the nucleus of this city. We love it. And it's a gas to work in.
I gotta go and put on my trauma clothes.
Of the 1840s to the high-tech industries of the 1990s, people have been drawn to San Francisco, seeking a life less ordinary.
People come out now because of the culture, and the weather is fantastic. You can go skiing in Tahoe, you can be in the sun. There's so much diversity here.
San Francisco is one of the most ethnically diverse cities in the world. There are many languages spoken, there are many colors, there are many customs, there are many traditions. It is a tolerant city that recognizes that our differences are in fact our strengths.
The entire spectrum of the Bay Area's sick and injured are treated at San Francisco General, a county hospital in the heart of the Mission District.
Next door to translate. The hospital itself is very diverse. Everyone is from a different ethnic background, and any language you can think of, we pretty much have it covered. My name is Rachel Chin. I'm a full-time attending in the emergency department at San Francisco General Hospital. I'm from New York City, born and raised in Chinatown. I've been here 9 or 10 years now. And oh, you know what? You speak Cantonese too? Great. There's a lot of Asians here. And living in Chinatown, I always had good Chinese food, so I picked a location where there would be good Chinese food.
You get the best food here. Hold on. Oh, shoot.
Ready? Whoa, it's a 912.
It's a 912. Oh, this is right here.
Felipe Castillo was having lunch at St. Anthony's Soup Kitchen when a man attacked him with a knife.
22-year-old male, Spanish speaking, stab wound to the right upper back and a large laceration to the left arm.
This gentleman has multiple stab wounds in his back and his arm, and his pressure is pretty low now. He's sweating a lot, worried about blood loss.
Just lay right back onto it. What was his pressure in the field?
Too bumpy to tell.
Although Felipe is awake and alert, he may be bleeding into his chest.
Did he tell you the blade or the length of the blade?
I don't speak Spanish.
Okay. Let me get a Spanish interpreter.
Titmus. Okay.
Nurse Mia Cooper gives medication, coordinates tests, and keeps track of all the activity in the trauma room.
It's a busy job. It's an important job. It's your responsibility to send off the appropriate bloods to make sure that serohematocrits are sent off.
Yeah.
Got a tartan screen. We'll send it.
Oh, you did. Oh.
You're also documenting what x-rays were taken, who is present in the room.
Right, I will chest x-ray.
The doctors will stand there and call out a survey on the patient. Sometimes it's really hard to hear, but the idea is that you filter what's being said and write down what's pertinent.
No, I told her who was having PVC.
Can you ask him if he saw the blade?
With a knife.
He doesn't have a pneumo on his chest.
The x-ray looks good. There is no sign of internal bleeding.
We were worried that it might have been deeper, but luckily it wasn't that deep.
Can I get him some morphine?
The team dresses Felipe's stab wounds, packing the holes with sterile gauze to prevent infection.
I'm getting some morphine for the gentleman in trauma one. Well, they're in the x-ray, so that's got to be hurting.
In terms of comforting the person, that actually it's our role to be a patient advocate. And I think sometimes through the flurry of a trauma resuscitation, we forget that these people have been through incredible trauma. And it's up to you to talk to these people and comfort them and reassure them that everything's going to be all right.
Senor,
I'm working on my Spanish. I love the language, and so I do practice with my patients speaking Spanish, and I use a lot of gesticulation at the same time. But I think each day I'm here, I learn one word.
Clear? Necesito mueves tú aquí, okay?
Felipe will need to be monitored closely. Mia sends him upstairs, where he'll spend the night. Blazing out of control in the Sunset District of San Francisco. Over 70 firefighters will come to battle the flames. The heat and the smoke take their toll.
Getting a San Francisco firefighter who fell 35 feet through a roof.
I'm pumped up right now. Feeling the rush.
My name is Theodore Deskalakis. I'm a second year general surgery resident. I'm originally from Greece. I came to the United States in 1995. I like the excitement of a trauma coming in. There's an adrenaline rush.
Do you want to get the trauma team down?
Yeah.
Get ready? Because we have to talk who's going to be in his reach room. Just bring him down.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead, Paige.
Lieutenant Bob Evans was trapped on the third floor of the blazing building. His only hope for escape from the advancing flames was through the window.
Okay.
Lieutenant Bob Evans, 48-year-old firefighter. He had to bail out, came down 2.5 floors, slowed his descent up with a ladder.
When we got there, he's awake, alert oriented, complaining of pain in the left ankle.
First degree burns, a little bit on the cranium, mostly on the extremities.
Okay, sir. What does it hurt? Just your legs?
Right now, my skin is burning.
Okay.
And my left ankle is really bothering me.
Okay. Belly hurt at all?
No.
No?
So whenever a fireman or a police officer get injured, the level of anxiety and stress does increase, but the level of care is no different.
Okay, I don't want you to move your neck, okay? Where else did you get burned?
I feel like my head is burning. I feel like my legs are burning.
Okay. Did you get burned in the back at all?
No.
So he has burns on the scalp.
There we go.
Oh! That's fine. Can you push on my feet? Not to left.
Is it broken?
I don't know yet. Okay. Let's give him 50 fentanyl. The knee hurt?
My skin hurt. I must be burned.
At the knee?
Yeah.
Bob has no broken bones, but he's torn the ligaments in his ankle and has first and second degree burns.
How do burns look?
You're looking good.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I don't think I'm bad.
That's what you say to everybody, though, I bet.
No, not me.
That'll be wrong, though.
You put some cold stuff on your head, eh?
Does that feel good?
Yeah.
A total of 12 firemen were hurt in the blaze. Their injuries will heal, but the events of the day will remain with them.
The fire started growing, and it just got hotter and hotter. My partner told me that he was out of air. We went and attempted to go down the stairs and met by a wall of fire. There was a ladder to the roof, and I took a dive for the ladder. And missed.
How soon to the mission?
Now we're about 2 minutes from the hospital.
We're getting multiple pediatric patients coming in. An 8-year-old that was unrestrained in the back seat of a high-speed MBA that hit a pole, and the kid might have a possible hip fracture. And we're getting two other kids that we don't know about.
When kids come in as a trauma, the level goes up a notch. And if we get three kids, we really worry about them, especially in a car accident, because we only have so much help.
They got a PD set up.
We have so many respiratory therapists, so many nurses around. And if the department's already really busy, you know that you're going to be pulling a nurse away from someone who's sick.
We have other rooms for the kids.
We have three rooms right now.
Yeah.
What's the other room for the... 1, 2, 3.
So what I have to do is to make sure things are orchestrated well in each room and to stay on top of things.
So Jackie will be running this?
Yeah.
And I'm going to follow the other two kids that will come in because we don't know how serious they are yet. You're actually the first spring break day, first nice day, first rain of the season, lots of accidents.
Dr. Chick organizes the nurses and residents as more patients arrive in the ER.
It's like an orchestra. If everything runs well, it is a well-performed orchestra.
This is Maria Sandoval.
Maria Sandoval and her three sons were on their way to the doctor's office when their car spun out of control and slammed into a pole.
She can move all her hands, her
feet. 8-year-old Jose is the first of Maria's three sons to arrive.
The car spun out, I would imagine, rather high speed. I would bet he was on the driver's side rear. He has pain to the left hip. I bet he was unrestrained in the vehicle. The vehicle lost the rear tire. Where are you hurting right now?
Over here?
Okay.
So we got a good airway and chest holes. You know where you are? Good. That hurts. What about right here? Does that hurt?
He's looking really good, very lucky. But we're still getting all the x-rays to make sure that he doesn't have a hip fracture. His left hip is hurting him, though. But everything else looks good.
We see a lot of kids, usually from a car accident or some sort of trauma.
You're going to feel tight. Keep your head still for me. Good, perfect. Just keep it right there. You're perfect. I'm going to hold your head still, okay?
Kids are resilient in some ways. We see them, we are aggressive with them, and they tend to do well.
You don't have any earrings on, do you?
The next two boys, 3-year-old Leonardo and 5-year-old Victor, arrive from the crash.
Don't be scared.
She complained pain in the shoulder.
Is he speaking
English?
Spanish only.
She speaks Spanish. It's really hard being the attending in charge and running from room to room. So if we get multiple traumas that come in, I cannot stay in one room.
This is the side that's hurting him. It's just this part right here.
I'm running into all the rooms all the time, making sure everything is okay. Some days I feel like I need rollerblades to zip from room to room.
Can you grab my fingers?
So it's Harvard. It's 121, 126 over 57, 100% O2 sat. Sometimes it can be pretty chaotic too, so might not be a perfectly performed orchestra, but so far today it's been pretty good.
The kids are all fine. They're going upstairs to the pediatric clinic to be watched for another couple of hours. One does have a clavicle fracture and one has the fracture on his hips, but other than that, they look great.
The man was hit by a car, lives in a wheelchair, hit at a high rate of speed, belly pain, flank pain. He'll be going into trauma 2 as a 911.
Yeah, chest x-ray and trauma 2 from 911.
This will be trauma alpha.
Alpha. Move the right away. 16 gauge.
We have field labs.
A history of insulin-dependent diabetes, MI, hypertension.
Can I squeeze my hands?
Do you remember everything?
No. Father John DeBoer.
Don't move your neck. What other bloods do you need? Second, right?
Yeah. Does your neck hurt back here?
Not really.
Not really?
I think it's still got backwards, but I think it was bad back in a way.
I've been screened for 4.
And it gave birth?
We'll get the chest x-ray, just hang and see what's going on.
As a UCSF resident, we rotate through 6 hospitals here in San Francisco City. San Francisco General Hospital is the only trauma center, and it's a good experience. I have to make decisions, but I'm always backed up with the attendings and the trauma senior.
Someone here? This guy has fractures. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Listen, I understand you had a dog on scene with you. I just want you to know the dog's okay and being taken care of.
You want to see the chest x-ray? He has 3, 4 rib fractures on the left. What? No.
What other injuries?
Scalp lack, which I haven't really evaluated because it's too far back.
I would go ahead and scan through his chest while you're scanning through the belly.
It's just 2 more minutes.
Did he drink the juice?
No, we're getting it right now.
Up on the 4th floor, firefighter Bob Evans is recovering from his fall.
They want to do surgery on my ankle, inserting a screw through my ankle area to pull everything back together that seemed to have separated as a result of the fall.
So try putting, put your foot down. Go crutches, then left, then right. Step this foot.
What I am is a firefighter. As soon as the doctor released me, I'm ready to get back to it. That's what I do. That's what I do.
Now stand up straight.
Okay. Sorry? We have to just take a look at your belly and make sure you don't have any other injuries yet.
I was in my bottom here?
Yep. Do you have one of those fast VA wheelchairs?
Yeah.
Yeah. The ones we try to avoid while you try to hit us while we're walking at the VA?
About 7 miles an hour.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hello, my name's Mia. I've got some contrast here for you.
English?
I'm Australian.
Australian?
I'm an Aussie, yeah.
But my dog is from Australia.
It's a blue heeler?
There's a dingo.
A dingo, right on.
A dingo terrier.
Right on. And she's okay, right?
I don't know.
That's what we were told.
People are always fascinated by an accent. They love guessing. It makes a lot of difference having an accent. I think sometimes you get away with a lot more. I don't know, I find you can win them over a bit.
You need to drink this solution. It's going to show up if there's anything wrong in your tummy. Take your time, all right? You don't have to... Tastes like Australian beer, right?
I don't know, don't drink it.
Here you go, try again.
It's really important to connect with people. It's like I'm human and you're human, and it's like a trust thing.
It's like a spot of tea.
Spot of tea?
Yeah.
See what we can do.
I think getting a bond like that with the patients, like I'm not a scary nurse or a cold nurse. I'm here to help you, and we're going to work together.
You're looking good, all right?
Yeah, I should. I'm so handsome, you know.
You are very handsome.
Yeah. I'm so lost.
He's cute. All right, here we go to the scanner.
Scanning Father DePaul's chest and abdomen will show if any of his internal organs were damaged by the impact of the car.
Got a fracture in left rib here. Spleen is okay. The liver is okay.
So why did you even have to admit him? I mean, he just has some rib fractures.
Rib fracture, you want to give him an adequate pain control so they won't splint and desag. Just given his medical history.
We're going to get you off this car and this hard board, okay?
Yeah.
Okay?
There is no organ damage, but the broken ribs could affect Father DePaul's breathing. He'll spend a few days in the hospital.
This is Dr. Chin. How do you copy?
We have the regular bread and butter, diabetics, heart attacks, hypertensions.
Yeah, one on the road like half an hour ago, and still all these things are coming in. This woman has a very large hip abscess. They're going to take her to the OR now.
Some people say that people go into emergency medicine for this adrenaline rush. I like it because it's always challenging. It's never a dull moment here. It's always interesting.
There's a 49-year-old male with a history of asthma.
Uh-huh.
For 2 days. No diabetic. Good inhaler at home.
Chest x-ray 22.
Help minimally. History of intubation 97. Respiratory rate is about 34, 36 when I first saw him.
Larry Shields has had asthma for most of his life. Usually it's under control, but today's massive attack has forced him into the ER.
When you get this bad, do you need a breathing tube? No? You let us know when you need a breathing tube, okay? You've had it twice before, so you let us know. You understand? Okay.
Asthma is a really bad disease. People who live with asthma sometimes might not realize how bad the disease can get, and they wait until the very last minute before they call an ambulance or come into the hospital.
All right. I'm gonna get an x-ray.
I'm gonna take some blood from your artery, okay? It does hurt a little bit, but we need it.
It's really important to see what your lungs are doing. That's why you get them when you get this bad.
You got a really bad exacerbation here, okay?
A lot of people die from asthma without even realizing how severe the disease can be.
Is there even a little hope?
And the problem is they can't breathe out. They can get the air in, but they can't get the air out. Because then everything in their lungs just starts to collapse and just constrict. So that's why they have that prolonged wheezing. And then they suffocate.
Hey, come here.
Yeah. What's up?
You're my wife.
Your wife? Okay.
I can't breathe.
interest to wait any longer, Larry. We gotta go now, okay?
Your breathing's not getting any better. It's getting worse.
So right now he's getting very tired of breathing. He's retracting all his muscles. So we are going to intubate him. I have asked the respiratory therapy and the anesthesiologist here.
What are you doing right now? We're giving you some medicine, okay, to make you feel more comfortable and let this intubation go smoothly. Like I said, the main priority for us is going to be making you feel comfortable so this isn't uncomfortable for you, all right?
Larry Shields is sedated so the doctors can put in a breathing tube.
Asthmatics have such small reserve that they decompensate so quickly that we have to intervene, intubating them and improving their breathing capacity.
It's going to take two hands to know all this.
I think that if he didn't come in the time that he did, he would have died. He's such a bad asthmatic, he was so tight that he definitely would not be breathing right now.
Larry will remain on the ventilator in the intensive care unit until he can breathe on his own.
That's what's very nice about emergency medicine. You feel good about making the right diagnosis and doing the right thing.
S-H-A-N-A.
What we're going to do, we're going to get you registered, Shannon, and then we're going to send you up for an x-ray. And what's your cat's name now?
It's that bump, I think, right there. I was sewing something in my living room, and the needle that I was sewing with got stuck in the carpeting. And I was looking for the needle, and I couldn't find it. And when I kneeled back down to continue sewing, I felt this pop in my knee. The needle went right in through my pants into my knee.
I'll just bring it for backup if I'm having troubles.
And you think it's actually in the particular space?
No. I don't think it's in there.
The needle in Shauna's knee is not only painful, but it could cause an infection. Theo decides it must come out.
We'll do it in here. I'm going to bring in a small fluoro unit just in case he'll need it. It's just an x-ray. What? No, I have to cover everything up. Okay, I'll be right back.
We have to miss our band rehearsal. We're in a band.
What kind of band?
Bulgarian music.
Bulgarian?
Bulgarian, I sing in it.
Oh. Why Bulgarian music?
It's soulful music. It's folk music. And for singer, it's really fun to sing that kind of music.
Yeah, I'm kind of aware of it. You can tell from my name.
We'll sing for you if you want.
Really?
Steshna Mahamohodama Vihidihishtile.
That's concentrate now.
There, you've got to concentrate. Oh, I'm sorry.
Doing wheelies.
Okay.
Do we have a cut-down tree here? And a jelly.
It's not that.
I'll probably start to feel it. Yeah, I see it.
Can we sing another song, Gina? Molly Todd?
Come down a little. San Francisco is a bizarre city, so we do have bizarre cases as well. It's not Greece. It's not Greece.
No, I feel it.
It's just hard to locate it.
Theo is having a hard time getting a grasp on the needle.
Trying to get it at the right angle. It's getting busy.
Scarce. We're just a little low on staff and a little high on patients. Medical admitted. Sickle cell being discharged. This is our femur fracture being discharged.
no, that's her, right?
I think most of us just live at this level.
You're gonna be okay.
We're best at a certain speed.
Great.
When it's something less than that, we're actually less sharp.
Mr. Pubia, I gotta go look at your x-ray. It looks like there may be a break in your finger, all right, which might change the way we treat it. All right, I'm gonna go back to x-ray right now, take a look at it, okay?
My name is Marshall Isaacs, and my role is both as an attending emergency physician here at San Francisco General and also to provide medical direction to the San Francisco Fire Department.
So you got a little break in the smallest bone at the end of your finger there. I chased ambulances and fire trucks when I was a little kid on my bike after school. My parents knew either I was going to be a lawyer or I was going to do this. Trauma one.
Two men stopped Mario Estevez on Market Street and demanded his money. Before he could run, the men attacked him with a knife.
So back of his neck, where else, right? Anything on the thorax?
No.
Deep breath. Respire profundo. He's got power on the blood cells.
I see nothing in his groin.
What's your access check?
Left arm.
We've got to roll them and make sure that there's no more bad. You can get rid of the C collar. Yeah. If it's just a stab, just get rid of it.
Top right, 19. Okay. Got it.
You've seen this or not?
Not yet. There's a small skin bleeder.
Okay, perineum scene?
Yes. We just need to wash off this wound. So far, we only have evidence of a single laceration in the posterior neck. And probably needs local wound aspiration.
Wanted to get anything through his IV?
Not at the moment.
One of the principles behind the trauma center is that when you see a lot of trauma patients, you know exactly what has to be done, and you treat each patient fairly similarly so that you don't miss any life-threatening injuries.
Chest is normal. Looks good. He was pretty sweaty when he came in. That's always worrisome, but that could just be from the release of hormones when we get excited, which certainly a stab wound would do, or it could be due to blood loss.
Because he's lost a lot of blood, the team will keep Mario in the ER for the next 6 hours.
You killed a lot.
He just had a baby?
After more than an hour, Theo still hasn't gotten the needle out of Shauna's knee.
I can feel it, but I just can't grasp it. Right there. I can even hear it.
Oh, needle, please dislodge yourself from the meat.
Does lidocaine have any weird effects here?
This might be a case for the journals.
Yeah. Side effects of lidocaine.
Oh, my God. Is it in the muscle?
No, I think it might be going into the joint. Yeah, that's tough tissue to dissect.
Theo suspects that the needle is deeper than he originally thought.
I might want the orthopedics to come in because it's probably in joint capsule.
Do you think it's under the knee cap and in the...
Well, it's in some dense tissue. That's pretty deep.
So the question is, are you under?
I don't think it's under the toe.
So your knee was bent when you're...
It was. It was totally floor. Yeah. What do you think about that?
Wow.
Do you think I should bend my knee?
No. I think we need to go upstairs and open it up.
The knee must be opened further. Shauna will have to go to the operating room.
I think it's in your joint, and I think your risk of getting an infection, if we don't, would be more than I'd want for your knee.
Yeah, your first evaluation is already done whenever you want to pick it up.
The relationship between the physicians, the nursing staff, the support staff, the medical students is among the best relationships I've seen in any place I've worked before.
Number one, stop touching my butt.
Not everybody looks the same, not everybody talks the same, not everybody acts the same, and not everybody considers relationships to be the same.
We're in San Francisco. I mean, where else can you wear hair like this?
your work.
Where else can you represent yourself?
Really? Yeah. Be yourself. And be happy to be yourself. You know?
Michael, he can go for the knee, right? And then he's going to come back and we're going to settle for a head CT.
I chose to settle here, and I think a lot of other gay and lesbian physicians, nurses, medical students, and healthcare workers have come to San Francisco, and it's not an issue.
Hey, hi, Marshall.
How are you?
Great, thanks. I'm going home.
Good for you. You do your job. You do it well. You treat people with respect, and they get to know you as a human being. And this is just one aspect of being a human being. It's not who I am, primarily. It's what I am.
Zone 2 of the ER sees many patients with chronic illnesses. Naomi Bronson's liver disease has caused her to retain a large amount of fluid in her belly.
So I have to breathe when I'm on my back.
In between her abdominal organs and the inside of her abdominal wall, she's had an accumulation of fluid. And that fluid is not serving any useful purpose. It is making her uncomfortable. And in this situation, we can remove that fluid and make her more comfortable, and that's what we're doing.
One of the things that I always try to do is to try to put one finger here to add some resistance to it. You could control how much pressure I'm putting on it distally. We serve the House of Medicine not only by providing direct patient care, but by teaching others how to care for emergency medicine patients, trauma patients, and showing them how to do a good job in this type of environment. They're stable as the needle, just at the point of entry.
Okay, you okay, ma'am? We're gonna go for it now, okay?
How to take care of the full spectrum of disease in its acute setting, and then again in its chronic, unrelenting setting. So I think it's an important experience for them.
It's coming out in the next few months. Might take a little while.
It's gonna take a while.
As long as it's coming out.
Do you have any pain right now?
It's going to come out.
14 hours after Shauna Kingsley arrived in the ER, the surgeons prepared to remove the sewing needle buried inside her knee.
I've had a couple cocktails, you know, I'm chilling out.
It's very relaxed.
Don't move. We're putting the medicine in.
Okay.
I'm so excited. Spinal injection.
We're gonna roll it away from us.
It's pretty weird. I want to move them, but I don't know how to.
Can I have a needle, please?
Spiral needle.
Thank you. It's the same kind of needle we used to put the anesthetic in her back. We're using it just to localize where the needle is now so we can make the incision in the correct spot and take out the her needle.
Hey,
you're too far north. Come back again. Shooting!
Okay, we just exposed our needle here.
Needle's out.
I'm so happy.
It's a girl! It's a girl!
Yeah!
I feel good now. I was able to bathe myself and shave and everything. You know, I had asthma since I was 2. I've never been anywhere like that.
7 days after his asthma attack, Larry Shields is finally breathing well enough to leave the hospital.
Been gone a whole week. So we're going home now.
In the emergency department, we see the people with chronic illnesses, but the process is acute.
Chest x-ray trauma too?
We see these same patients over and over again.
My nurse came out to see me today, and I literally collapsed her feet when she got there. Believe me, that made me feel a little foolish.
Michael Manthe has been HIV positive for 18 years. His immune system has deteriorated, leaving him susceptible to disease and infection.
Michael has end-stage AIDS, and he is developing increasing shortness of breath over the past week, but he says he always has difficulty breathing because he has asthma and some pulmonary lung disease. And since he's getting worse, his doctor wanted him to come in to be evaluated.
Can you turn your head against my hand as hard as you can? Heart? The other way. Very good.
What medicines is he?
Just all of these?
Yeah. Okay. Have you been taking all these medicines?
Yeah.
Okay. How long have you been having fevers for?
Off and on for about 18 years.
Okay. Well, someone with AIDS who comes in shortness of breath, first thing we think of is PCP pneumonia, which is prevalent in patients who are HIV positive with low CD4 counts. It's a pneumonia that we can treat with antibiotics, and he would get better.
Do you want a chest
X-ray? I ordered it already. Yeah. Have you ever had PCP or pneumonia? No? I'm going to talk to the other doctor, okay? I think Dr. McCune might have called her and told her about you, so I'm going to find that out. There is a very large HIV population, and all the nationally recognized physicians working on AIDS, developing pharmaceutical protocols are all here at San Francisco General Hospital. And I think we provide one of the best cares for HIV patients in the country.
Looks like you might have PCP pneumonia, sir, so you can't accept it. There's other treatments that we can start.
Michael Manthe needs a combination of antibiotics and respiratory therapy. He'll be admitted into the hospital.
Oh, antiretrovirals. Let's see, which one is he on? I'm actually doing research in HIV and people who are HIV positive who come into the emergency department. Right now, with the new treatments for HIV disease, people are healthy for a very long time, but there's no cure. It can be treated only temporarily. It's still a devastating disease and terminal.
Hove over her foot.
Stephanie, she says she had her foot run over by an automobile, low speed, like parking speed. I see no deformity, no gross bleeding. But it is painful.
Okay, take a look at your foot here.
It doesn't appear to have any tire marks on it.
Where does it hurt? On your foot?
Okay.
Do you feel my finger here on your toes?
Barely.
X-ray of the ankle and foot.
You just pay medications.
We have a lot of different personalities that come in as trauma victims, and it's an interesting experience.
The team makes an unusual discovery. Daphne has surgical staples in her head from an accident last year. She's been afraid to have them taken out.
We can easily take them out. Oh, I'm so hard. It's from last year. She's scared of them.
We can give you some pain relief here, and we can get them out for you, okay?
So come on, sit, feel it.
Then they'll be all out.
Come on, come feel it.
No, you won't feel it.
Did it happen like last December? June.
We'll get the rest out for you. No, it won't hurt.
I'll take care of it.
Okay.
Well, a lot of people neglect themselves. Some people just don't want to come to a hospital and will do anything to prevent a doctor seeing them.
I feel like so insane. Yeah.
That is so gross. I'd say this wound is well healed.
It's my tooth. Is that all that she's supposed to do?
Yeah, for a year. You want staples?
You want staples.
Where's staples?
I'm so glad that we took them out, though.
They told me it was going to hurt, so I never came back.
Daphne's foot is broken. She'll go home with a cast, but no staples.
We'll be back. You'll have a cast.
I've never thought of doing anything else than being a surgeon.
Yeah, that's trauma one.
I need 4 more years in San Francisco to complete my residency.
At some point, I want to go back to Greece and continue my practice there. See things change there.
Bye.
Okay, we're taking you out now.
5-year-old called Chanel and her mother, Leslie Williams, were waiting in an intersection when another car hit them from behind.
No seatbelts. She got rear-ended. She hit the dashboard. No LSD. She started crying immediately. She says her back hurts.
My head hurts and my neck. I'm more mad than anything else.
My name's Marshall. Can you squeeze my hand for me?
Good girl.
How old are you?
Five.
Squeeze this one too. Good girl. How do you feel?
Much better.
Much better?
Now turn your head all the way to the left. Stop if you feel any sharp pains, and all the way to the right. Okay, good.
Wiggle your toes for me. Let me see your toesy-wozies move. Can you wiggle your toes?
Great, honey.
To me.
I love being a doctor.
Anything hurt?
No.
What's interesting is the range of possibilities, the range of human circumstances.
So I think you're just shook up a little bit.
Yeah.
You think you're able to walk now?
Leslie and her daughter have only minor injuries. Still, Marshall must reassure the shaky mom.
She should just follow up with her pediatrician, okay?
She looks great.
Okay.
As a doctor, you can reach out and touch other people, make that experience, however horrible it is, better than it might have been if it hadn't been you and trying to help them through it. It's real important that when she's in the car, that she be restrained appropriately, okay? It's important, okay? All of us try to make a difference with our patients, and I don't just mean the doctors, I mean the nurses, the support staff. The one underlying theme here is patient advocacy. I'm not saying that doesn't exist in other places, but I've never experienced it to the degree that I do here.
Jason, lean back for me, okay?
Let me get your blood pressure.
Do you know where you are right now, Jason?
I think we see ourselves as a safety net for our community.
A lot of patients are indigent. They don't have anybody to care for them or nobody to do for them, but we do, you know?
So why don't you have a seat here? Nurses come out and take care of you.
Needle stick in your hand here, fella.
You had a fall off the fence, so we're all here taking care of you.
I just took a peek at him. He has right buttock abscess. It needs to be a minute.
Okay.
There is something about county hospitals. It brings everyone together. It's sort of an extension of a family. It's not that this is my department, I do this and you do that. Everyone is working together. Let me just get you a base. Oh, you have a base on? You are so prepared. And then I'm always learning something new too.
Nice job.
I feel really lucky to work in a job where you're learning like this and you're seeing real life situations, dealing with people, you're dealing with, as far as I'm concerned, things that really matter.
I'm gonna go home now.
I really think you can make a difference.